ऐसे इकोलॉजिकल इम्पेरेटिव एंड इंटेंशनल फैमिली जर्नल वन द केस एट कूडारम बाय वाइस रिटन ऑन मंडे अक्टूबर 2nd 2006 The event. Friday, the 28th of July 2006, saw an unassuming beginning of what could possibly be a major turning point in some of our lives. On this day, the foundation was laid for the formation of an intentional family. The case. So, what does this word intentional family or IF mean? Well, quite simply, an IF is a family that stays together because it's so intense and not additionally because it is joined by historical or potential genetic linkages. In other words, the motto of an IF is we intend, hence we are family. The question then arises how an IF differs from an IC or intentional community. One could say that the difference lies in the level of connect and commitment. For any human being, there seem to be three basic identification and organization levels: individual level, family level, and community level. The organization structure is typically in the direction of individual to family to community. Community being an agglomeration of individuals and families at any level, from an apartment complex to the nation and beyond. Individual level is self-explanatory. However, family and community levels, especially when qualified using the word intentional, can be a little confusing. In my view, this can be understood using the example of caregiving. Typically, when a member of the family is unwell, the other members of the family give care to that person, either directly themselves or indirectly by paying or arranging for the same. On the other hand, when a member of the community is unwell, the responsibility of the rest of the members of that community typically does not extend beyond visiting or inquiring once in a while, and perhaps giving some peripheral support. If there is any greater support, it is generally at an institutional level, thereby reducing greatly the burden on any single member. Understanding this difference is crucial to deciding which set of individuals are connected or wish to be connected at an IF and which at IC level. But why do we need this new kind of family? This is the key question. In fact, the actual players and mechanisms of this particular IF are quite irrelevant at this time and will not be touched at all. This paper aims only at partially outlining an answer to this why. The rest of the questions can wait. Why the introduction? The simple answer to the why is that IF is a key component of the response required for containment of the undesirable byproducts of prevailing socio-economic system. The prevailing socio-economic system, simply defined, is the one in which the market is the God Almighty. Of course, like any successful paradigm, the market system has given humankind a lot of benefits. But again, like any successful paradigm, it must one day outlive its usefulness. How close are we to that day? Or can one suspect, looking at the negative effects of undesirable byproducts generated by this system, that the crossover may have already happened? What follows is not the painting of the market system as an evil. It only details how the excess of any good thing takes us beyond the peak benefit or optimum level and actually starts giving us negative returns. This is the universal course followed by any entity in nature or even in artifice. Food is good for us, but we all know what happens when we overeat. Exercise is good, but even that is known to harm us when the body is not given sufficient rest to recuperate from the rigors of working out. Bull markets are considered good for investors, but every investor worth his salt knows what happens when the market does not correct for too long a time. Tall buildings are the pride of every society, but the people designing those or living and working in there know how much of a pain an arbitrarily tall building can be. The question that we all need to ask today is, when everything in life and otherwise has a point of diminishing returns, can the market system alone be not subject to that universal law? And if it does have that point, where is it? How close are we to it? Or, as an island planet, have we already crossed it? Why? Knowing ourselves, needs and wants, demand and supply. All success today is defined wholly and solely by success in the market. Nations and governments must submit themselves to the altar of this God by continuously posting economic growth, economic development, increased GDP, etc. Never mind that these could either be due to improvement in, which is fine, but even due to deterioration of the quality as well as the eventual quantity of life. Case in point is that the GDP increases when cigarettes are manufactured and sold, and also when lung cancer patients are given therapy or terminal care. Similarly, GDP increases when sweetened waters are sold with all the razzmatazz of huge advertising budgets, and also when fancy weight reduction clinics charge you a small fortune for doing the most natural of things, spending energy and eating only as much as you need. Individuals, families, as well as communities rate their success on similar tunnel vision parameters. All want to increase their monetary wealth, or more properly, monetary income. Rarely does one take a breather to consider some of the fundamental facts about money. The primary one is that, shorn of all adornments like sophisticated toys and conveniences, money is merely the representation of natural resources that the owner of that money can command at a given time. This leads us to the corollary that being limited in time and space, each of us will never be able to use more than a very limited amount of those resources, unless we waste, which we do colossally in our lifetimes or in the lifetimes of people that we rarely care about. This is statement A. Another is that there are always two sides to any question, and in the process of making our ends meet, we actually have two sides and not merely one side of the question that we command varying degrees of control over. We can increase our supplies, that is, we can increase our income, but then most often that part is more in someone else's control than in our own. Statement B1. We could also simultaneously work on the other side of the equation, that is, we could reduce the demand, thereby reducing the gap between our ends. Again, shorn of all adornments like dreams, desires, wishes, and wants, one's needs are not that great after all. Statement B2. At this juncture, it is important to delineate the difference between needs and wants. A need is that without which one cannot continue living. A want is that without which one will not allow oneself to continue living happily. Statement B3. Typically, most needs have been needed by human beings for millennia. Generally, these are some kind of natural or internal to a person, or social needs, inclusive of status, esteem, respect, etc. They are also almost involuntary, as opposed to wants, which arise out of one's own volition. Typically, a want could be an inflated need of the kind mentioned above, or some kind of an artifact, or as yet, an imaginary thing. A need is timeless and is typically always there, either in active or dormant state. A want, on the other hand, is active for a while and, when fulfilled, usually disappears completely, generally to be replaced by a greater want of similar kind. Typically, one will have enjoyed the fulfillment of the earlier want only partially before he will become dissatisfied with merely that level of the want. Wants, thus, are limitless, and their fulfillment generally condemns one to a keener desire of a greater magnitude in that same want space. One's needs are not really under one's control, though wants clearly are. Further, if we analyze our expenses, it becomes obvious that a vast majority of the expense incurred by the people reading, hearing, or watching this piece will fall in the category of wants rather than of needs. Statement B4. A need is thankfully predictable, and when active, is at more or less the same level at which it was in the previous episode of activity. Hence, it makes sense to fulfill needs because A, the payout is really huge. One gets to survive. B, needs are predictable, hence amenable to a planned and thereby almost certain fulfillment. And most of all, C, because they are actually satiable, even though only for a time. Fulfilling a want, on the other hand, condemns one to the vicious circle of ever-inflating wants, which, by definition, sooner or later become unfulfillable. Wants, thus, are insatiable. Therefore, if it is satisfaction that one is after, striving for the fulfillment of one's wants actually takes one farther away from his goal. It makes one spend more and more time, energy, life force, and of course, money, condemning one to constantly strive to increase the supply side. Statement B5. Yet another fact about money is that we have allowed it to become a primary, or perhaps in some societies, the only arbiter of the fundamental value of our life, status, respect, esteem, and generic love that other people give us. Statement C. Today, we generally respect the mainstream people, because they do, can, or already have, generally through means currently considered legitimate, made money. People are respected for other reasons too, but all those are either add-on to their wealth, or those people are considered different, hence not subject to the mainstream respect-giving conventions. We need to question if this is the way we should be. Should we continue living in service of the creation, our money, or should money exist in service of creating greater quality in our longer lives? Question B. A corollary of the above is that monetary wealth or income has therefore been rendered irrelevant in its absolute value. In reality, we care about our wealth not in terms of what it can purchase for us, but in its measure as relative to those that we consider our peers. Statement E. This perception of money is different from, say, that of what we eat or the leisure that we feel we necessarily must have, both of which are more enjoyed in their absolute values, more or less irrespective of the quantities that our peers prefer to enjoy. This further underlines my assertion earlier that money is used by most of us in the most part for want and not need fulfillment. For needs are essentially absolute and wants are essentially relative. My needs, for example, are limited to getting sufficient nutrition, protection, leisure, plus quality physical, emotional, and sexual connection with other human beings. These all have their absolute values, that is, have a definable maximum fulfillment, beyond which they go dormant. My wants, on the other hand, have ranged from getting a place to even stand in a train for a journey longer than 30 hours to owning a large enough tropical island and way, way beyond. They change based on what I already have and what my peer group has. In summary, statement A helps us to conjecture that for a vast majority of us on this planet, our earnings, however low those are, could actually be enough if we just allowed ourselves to entertain that possibility. After all, our ancestors not too long ago had subsisted on much less, and going by the greatness that they did create, were not living an inferior quality of life. Statement F. Statements B1 to B5 lead us to conclude that one must focus more on the demand, that is, on expense rather than on the income side of the monetary equation, since that is more controllable by ourselves. Statement G. When studied along with the law of diminishing returns, the same statements lead us to conclude that blind, uncontrolled race for greater income reduces overall quality of life. Statement H. This is actually common sense. When you're doing nothing other than focusing on increasing your income, you're likely to miss out on the other important things in life. After all, quality life requires many things other than merely money. In fact, pursuit of income is at the cost of a huge outlay of time. The only resource that a human being cannot regain having lost it. Furthermore, having gained money at this tremendous cost, one cannot even enjoy the pleasures that money can buy, since one does not have time even for those. Finally, an observation about any and all of human expectations. Happiness follows when supply is greater than demand. Misery when demand is greater than the supply. Statement J. Statement/question I, not allotted. Juxtaposing the statements A to J, we can easily conclude that the key to being happy lies not in being greatly wealthy or in having a great income, but rather in practicing temperance in one's demands. Perhaps it is best that was statement K. Perhaps it is best to let dreams and desires and wishes and wants and hopes and aspirations to remain just those, never allowing them to grow up into expectations or, God forbid, into demands. For then, we set ourselves up for unhappiness. Statement L. Why delving deeper? Of course, notwithstanding statement C mentioned earlier, there are people in this world who find it extremely difficult to get enough cash flow to meet their basic needs. But they are not the ones who have set up this market system, nor are they its primary beneficiaries. In fact, it is these economically weakest people that have the least voice in the system. The term market system or free market is, after all, an artifact invented by rich people and their agents in order to enjoy all the benefits that wealth gives them and yet shed all the responsibility for their actions. Something they could not easily do when the same system was called capitalism. Market is a faceless, nameless, responsibility-less entity in whose name an economically powerful person can do almost anything and blame the market forces. In the words of John Kenneth Galbraith, this terminology provides them functional anonymity. Imagine if you were to rebuke someone on a personal matter and he goes and commits suicide because of your berating him. You are likely to be questioned and possibly held partially accountable for that suicide. If, on the other hand, you had fired the same person from his job in your capacity as his manager for reasons of a recent merger, in other words, for market reasons, you and the rest of the world with you are likely to shrug your shoulders, blame his suicide on market forces, and proceed with firing the person next in line. So, though the market system works in the service of the rich and of those who are willing to make everything subservient to it, it is not really the savior of the poor that it is made out to be. Unfortunately, its votaries very effectively pretend that the system is designed for creating opportunities for poor people. The others swallow that hook, line, and sinker. They even accept the richer folks' wealth growing at a rate faster than their own, increasing not just the difference, but even skewing the ratio to a greater extreme. They accept these horrendous income disparities willingly in the hope that the poor will also make it economically big one day, should there be continued economic growth. Of course, no one questions the necessity of trying to become rich. Is there no other possible way of living a quality life? Question M. Today, the stranglehold of market system of belief is so constricting that very few people dare talk, think, or even dream in any other language. At all levels of discourse, there seems to be only one panacea: economic growth for all kinds of ills. Even communist governments, let alone individuals, families, communities, and institutions, believe that we can economically grow out of any problem. The logic is unethical, a bit like consoling a young man with a leg shorter than the other that he is growing and very soon the shorter leg will increase in length and that his problems will go away. What no one tells him is that even if he were to grow to a height of 50 feet, the shorter leg is likely to remain shorter than the longer one. In fact, the disparity in absolute terms will be even greater at 50 feet than it was at 4. And with the system supporting growing disparities, even the ratio between the longer and shorter is becoming greater. It is critical to appreciate that the example above is about the relative difference between the two legs and not about the absolute length of each. Just like that of money and that of wants. As mentioned earlier, absolute money is most often irrelevant for people unless they make lesser than required to meet their basic needs. I have always found that when a person does not know the salaries of his peers, he is generally fine with his salary. He has problems with it only when he finds that he gets paid substantially less than a friend with similar responsibilities and productivity, or when a competitor offers him a substantially greater salary, again underscoring the same point. The logic of presenting economic growth as a panacea is also specious, as nothing can grow forever. Infinitely growing economy is about as real a concept as a perpetual motion machine. This is because there are limits to every system that can exist in the real world, as opposed to the world of imagination. In this real world, we are bound to this earth. There are no real options available elsewhere, and the earth is a limited spherical island, which means that unlimited real growth is not possible. Of course, creative accounting can create an impression that it is so. Therefore, in my mind, there is no doubt that we will necessarily have to think of some other solutions to our problems. And today is as good a day as any other to start thinking of finding those. In fact, yesterday would have been better, but we do not have the luxury of turning the clock back. So we must start thinking and acting today, at least. But why such a rush? It is so because the current paradigm has already taken us way too close to the precipice of drawing more than the system can tolerate, thereby risking a system crash. And if we do not act soon, it may not be possible to stop ourselves in time before the mad rush towards economic growth has unraveled our earth and along with it our systems, our civilization, our lives. One must never forget that the Right Venerable Mr. Economic Growth can only be achieved through ever-increasing consumption by ever-increasing number of people. Statement N. This necessity has resulted in and will always result in a focused drive towards stripping the world of all natural resources by all means and utilizing them in service of greater consumption. Statement P. Statement/question O, not allotted. Similarly, all non-monetary social and support systems and institutions are fast being unraveled through this unthinking pursuance of the market system and economic growth. Statement Q. This last statement needs a little explanation. Today, the market god demands that extended families and joint families be broken down into nuclear families, which in turn should preferably be reduced to single parent families, and perhaps best of all is to have single person households. How else can you achieve the creation of 10 households for 10 adults, thereby creating a demand for 10 apartments, 10 TVs, 10 washing machines, etc., instead of one of each? And without creating this artificial 10x demand, we cannot beat our neighbor in the economic growth sweepstakes. It may seem like there is no connection between the worship of market and unraveling of families, but there is a very strong link. It is probably not a conspiracy, but the marketers and corporate bureaucrats are the strongest advocates of consumer individualism. Most of their messages in some way exhort us to just do it or break free. But from what? Certainly from the supposed stranglehold of social conventions, the strongest of which is the family. As more and more of us feel that we are being subjected to unfair demands from our families, we drift away and the family structure eventually collapses. But where have we landed? From hell into heaven? Or from frying pan into fire? From the stranglehold of the family and social norms to the stranglehold of the corporations, the market god. And how can we ever forget that underneath the demands of any social institution, there is most often a connect. They expect certain behaviors from us because at some level they care at least a wee bit. Does the market god or its disciples care about anyone or anything in any measure other than making money? Does anyone exist as a human being other than as a link in the consumption chain? Perhaps there was always a need for loosening the straitjackets that some of our social norms put us under. But why reject that system wholesale and land into the clutches of the soul-crushing shark that is the market god? We are seeing the family size reduce from the clan to the extended, to the joint, to the nuclear, to the single parent, to the single person family. We shall also see more and more family or community based free services get monetized and come under the formal economy. So you already find bottled water everywhere, while the taps run dry, streams and wells turn poisonous. Biological families choose to put elders in old age homes, sick in nursing homes, even when all they might need is tender loving care from loving family members. Things will get worse. I can see the time when babysitting will attract service tax. as soon as someone will have hit upon the idea of having uniform quality crèches in all upmarket neighborhoods of all metros, McDonaldizing all things which were anyway available earlier, free of monetary cost, and were also of better quality. McBurgers are nowhere near the best burgers that I've eaten, and more than that, when a member of the family or community does the babysitting, for reasons of reciprocal obligations, they do it with some measure of love, not out of impersonal professional ethic. All in the service of the market god, all for the love of economic growth. World changes, and no one should grudge the passing of an institution and the coming up of another. But some fundamentals that are the basis of all natural human happiness cannot be allowed to be killed merely because we are blinded by the dazzle of some glittering new wonderful artifact. Because no artifact can ever provide the same level of fundamental satisfaction that can be provided by the simple pleasures that human beings evolved with. If that is not correct, why is it that most of us yearn for a plant or an animal, if not a human being next to us, despite having the sleekest of steel and glass offices for us to work and live in alone? Free of all obligations and expectations. And the market god, as opposed to market, the tool that was meant to serve the community, is merely an artifact, a recent invention by human beings. I wonder, while we continue creating and nurturing this Frankenstein of a god, have we ever questioned whether the market is serving us or we the market? We seem to somehow think that market god is on our side and nature against us. We never pitch ourselves against this all-controlling demon of an artifact, but we always find it very easy to pitch ourselves as the adversaries of nature. Look at any number of one-liners like "Nature Strikes Back," "Fact is Stranger than Fiction," "I climbed the Everest because it was there," "Nature versus Nurture," "Natural and Man-made," "Gravity-defying Edifice." We actually think that we can conquer or rival nature. This, despite ever being a minuscule part of the very same nature. So, this paradigm of industrialization and free markets that had given us such wonderful gifts as improved health, longer life expectancies and greater leisure needs to be examined if it has turned into a cancer that will eat away the quality and eventually the quantity of human life, if left to grow unchecked. In fact, even as I write, it is being encouraged to grow by every person and every institution that matters. There are clear signs that we are at unsustainable levels of human population and consumption, and are putting the biosphere under unprecedented stress. We are disrupting natural systems without a thought to our ability or otherwise of setting those back in order. Are we beyond the point of diminishing returns, or are we not? Do we not owe it to ourselves to at least debate that possibility? Is that debate and freedom not supposed to be the fundamental building block of free market and democracy? For if we have a long way to go before we hit that point, this debate can simply be another activity for passing time for some of us. Just like a billion others choose to watch a certain number of men or women running after some kind of a spherical object, or perhaps sway tortuously in front of cameras and mics. This debate, when encouraged, will at least have a payout in the sense that if we are close to or beyond the tipping point, we can possibly try to correct our direction while we still might have time. And either way, the undesirable byproducts of this successful paradigm need to be addressed anyway. The debate will focus our energies on that front and allow us to find better solutions for the peripheral problems, even if the central paradigm is still good for a long time to come. I just hope that when the rest of humanity mulls over these subjects, it remembers to listen to the people who are and will be involved in this debate and does not sideline them as some kind of green fanatics. One finds that when matters of eco-destruction comes up, the votaries of free markets suddenly start questioning the motivations and the knowledge levels of the people that have spent lifetimes in these matters. However, these same free marketers always give the benefit of thought leadership about football when it comes to the matters of football to people who play, discuss and watch football and do not claim to be experts on those matters themselves or push their paid agents upfront as counterweights to the opinions and findings that bother them. Long live successful paradigms, and longer live the spirit of questioning successful paradigms. Long live the market god, and longer live another god if we need to discover, locate, or invent one. Fleshing out the byproducts. One of the most celebrated results of industrialization and subsequent market system dominance has been a greatly improved life expectancy. Consequently, there has been a human population explosion. You do not hear this term very often these days. We now see increased humans as increased number of consumers. Hence, necessarily welcome this explosion as one of the primary tools of economic growth. This population explosion, along with the explosion in consumption, is the primary culprit in generating the undesirable byproducts in this era of the market god. Actually, the primary culprit is only consumption. In the so-called developed world, it is more fanned by the affluence and belief in market god. In the developing world, it is more because of the high and fast increasing population. The more we reproduce, the more we consume. The more affluent and market-driven we are, the more we consume, and consequently, the more we create these undesirable byproducts. Perhaps in the modern era, humans are no more humans. We are just consumption machines. Our mantra today seems to be consumo ergo sum. And where we have not reached that stage yet, we continue believing in reproducto ergo sum. The real problem with living these slogans is that the stress on the biosphere is fast taking us towards a situation where too many of its myriads of interconnected systems are beginning to fail. Which is what are the undesirable byproducts? Put simply, these are the uncorrectable disruptions of natural systems. Statement R. By uncorrectable, I mean uncorrectable by humans in the span of a human lifetime. So, which are these disrupted systems and why do they matter to us? Many of these are primary natural systems ensuring our survival and they are under threat due to the disruptions caused in a substantial measure by our consumption. The most talked of systemic change that we are seeing is the climate change. There has been enough said and enough written about it. One need not reiterate the main premises. The only thing that one needs to question is the efforts of several of the high priests of the market god to remove this discussion from public discourse. If there is even a remote possibility of a disaster striking, do we not discuss it? So then, why are we finding some people trying to sweep the matter under the carpet? Interestingly, the logic generally given is that if anything radical is done about addressing the climate change issue, we risk faltering on the economic growth front. Closely associated with climate change is the looming energy crisis. Again, there is enough data available on the phenomena of peak oil as well as peak gas. It does, of course, seem certain that we will be able to use alternate sources for a while, but the pollute potential of coal gasification, shale oil, tar sands, and the added security risk associated with nuclear energy will make it impossible for us to keep to our life in business as usual mode. We will still want economic growth and hence the demand for energy will keep going up with every new breakthrough in technology. This is probably going to disrupt our lives in many ways. Having been an energy addict, we will have no option but to go through the cold turkey syndrome sooner or later. Oil and gas have an additional role as a grain producer. A lot of food grain output is maintained at high levels by huge amounts of fertilizer application. Most fertilizers use hydrocarbons as feedstock. Over a period of time, with increasing scarcity of oil and gas, we will see scarcity of food grains. Food, as a percent of our monthly expense, will increase significantly. Again, the class of people who will not be able to afford it will be the economically weakest, in whose name we keep asking for economic growth. There are other challenges too on the grain production front. Since 1984, growth in the grain harvest is falling behind the growth in population. Further, most countries are facing acute water crisis. The amount of fresh water produced each year is essentially fixed by nature. Population growth shrinks the water available per capita and results in severe shortages in some areas. Irrigation water is diverted to industrial and residential use. The resultant water shortages could drop food production per person in many countries to that below the survival level. Of course, we are finding ways to use the same water more productively, but will there not be a limit after which we will not be able to increase the efficiencies anymore? What then? Even where there may not be an active water crisis at this time, the same is looming on the horizon. Many rivers across the continents, previously perennial, now fail to reach the sea for varying parts of the year. Even without considering the loss to other species and to humans as a result of this disruption, what will happen once we cross a critical usage level? As in, when we start using up close to all the water in the hydrological cycle, pipe it from desalination plants on the sea face? Again, this will require a huge amount of energy. Where will we sink all the dissipated energy and the pollution generated in the process? Water tables are falling on every continent. Irrigated area per person is falling. Water scarcity is food scarcity. With globalization having connected most of the world as a single unit, local crises can now be more effectively managed. However, our vulnerability to a global crisis has increased. A crisis which will certainly come sooner rather than later. Cropland per capita has been reducing. This is due to several factors, including population growth. Soil erosion is removing huge swathes of land out of usability. Further, improper irrigation techniques have led to salination and waterlogging in many lands, resulting in the loss of that cropland. Overall, cropland suitable for grain cultivation per capita has been reducing for 60 years or so, but the reduction expected in the next 50 years means the world will have a major challenge. Future population growth will reduce this critical number in many societies to the extent that they will no longer be able to feed themselves. India, Iran and Pakistan, for instance, will see grain land per capita shrink to less than 1/4 of an acre, that is, less than 12,000 square feet by 2050. As if the reduction in grain land availability was itself not problematic enough, we are also running severely short of land that can be brought under cultivation. There is not a lot more land on this earth that can be sustainably cultivated for grains. Further, Human beings are already using about 50% of net primary productivity of the land on this earth. The rest of the zillions of species are left with only the remaining half. This further limits any possibility of great increases in cropland. Biodiversity is consistently being reduced. Looking at it from a very limited prism of human food security, we must not forget that all high-yield and disease-resistant crops are a result of technologically mixing genes from the wild relatives of the food crops. As more and more wilderness disappears, and more uniformity comes in the grain varieties sown, we are at greater risk of not being able to find solution to future problems that will endanger our crops. One of the other key foodstuffs the world across is seafood. Oceanic fish catch is close to maximum exploitation. Not much room there but to go down. Of course, we will find a solution for that too. Perhaps figure out some way to do captive breeding within the oceans. However, the point to ponder is that with every limit that we cross, we are breaking some or the other natural system. How many can we break and get away? Statement S. And most importantly, why do we have to keep surmounting natural limits? Question T. Is it just because we choose not to rein in our consumerist desires, which are anyway not satisfiable on account of being limitless, or rein in our population, which can certainly be reduced over a few generations through natural attrition if we did decide to do it? Questions U and V. All this makes for a difficult future as far as food and energy security is concerned. Again, in a market system, it is the economically weakest that are going to face the brunt of the challenge. This will also mean political instability, and as a result, no one, not even the rich dudes, can really hope to stay absolutely untouched by this crisis. Forest and protected areas, quite apart from being valuable for other species that ensure the proper functioning of the biospheric system, are also important from the perspective of medicinal plants that can be found there. These are all under threat. Not only is the total forest area going down, the quality of remaining forests is also going down. On the socio-political front, there are many challenges too. Worldwide, due to the dominance of naked market forces, jobs availability is going down. Certain pockets are seeing booms, but the boom will turn to bust when the giant corporations decide that they have found a new lower cost location. This will leave the old location in shambles, for the people there would have already lost their old ways of coping and will not know how to handle the new crisis. Due to increasing competition, most corporations need to be financially very fit. One of the easiest ways for ensuring that is to reduce the workforce. Productivity norms are constantly going up. This makes for very stressful careers, even when people actually do get and do keep a job. All this is going to be a major concern area in future. Additionally, over the next 50 years, the number of aspirants into the job market will be even greater, pushing unemployment to levels that could, again, be politically destabilizing. Rapid urbanization is killing the traditional coping methods in the traditional rural or semi-rural homelands. New cities come with their own problems of housing, street crime, urban sprawl, slums, and a generally reduced quality of life. Runaway demand for various materials, from metals to compounds to timber, results in wastelands being left behind, where earlier there were thriving communities and species. The pressure for increased incomes or economic growth makes for production and sale of goods that are really not needed. Oftentimes, these are never even used. The pointless pollution generated as a result is choking previously healthy landscapes. One of the problems generally not seen connected with the population and consumption pressures is that of intra and inter-people conflicts. These take various forms and are called by various names depending upon which side of the conflict the caller is more uncomfortable with. We shall continue to see increased resource wars camouflaged as ideological wars. We shall also see wanton violence or terrorism, again camouflaged by an increasing fringe as some kind of an ideological necessity. We are the first species in the planet's history to trigger a mass extinction, and we know that we do not understand the consequences of such a heavy loss of animal and plant species. Our population and our consumption are changing the natural course of our planet, and this new direction will certainly affect us in turn. All this and more must be seen. All this and more must seem as enough evidence to state that we are approaching a number of natural limits. Pretending that all these are unconnected developments and not due to the overuse of available resources and to human demands gone wild limits any potential of our applying an effective solution to these problems. Statement W. Those who wish to see the future need only read a little bit of history. What happened, for instance, in Easter Island just might happen on a much grander scale to the whole world. A person more radical than I may have suggested that we introduce licensing for both. Consumption above a certain low accepted limit and for reproduction. After all, when we can license a simple and comparatively harmless activity like driving, why are we not exploring the possibility of licensing the activities that are far more insidious to our comfortable lifestyles, if not to our lives directly? Why do we need to reproduce so much that population must increase? Can we not reproduce only to the extent that the population can gradually reduce to more manageable levels? Why is it that individual liberties must be accorded to everyone on these two fronts. When, for example, we do not accord liberties to people to dig up the roads on their whims and fancy, or smoke in libraries, or swing their hands irrespective of disagreeing noses falling in their paths. After all, an increase in population, an increase in consumption is as much affecting those not reproducing and not consuming. On a less radical note, why is it that we must consume so much, especially when, and I can say that with first-hand experience, a lifestyle with lower consumption is far more peaceful, happy, loving, and beautiful lifestyle than the one with higher consumption. Statement X. Is it not time that we got rid of our insecurities and started focusing at least a little on the more controllable and productive side of the demand-supply equation? Is our current state not the case of our being obsessed with just one side of the equation, that is, ensuring supply for all kinds of overconsumption, instead of managing both the sides of the equation? Question: why? Pointers to solutions. The problems listed above are not exhaustive. It is possible that some other problems may also be linked to our overconsumption, including the overconsumption that is due to overpopulation. And as seen earlier, overconsumption is a direct result of our having adopted marketism as a religion. It is also possible that some of these problems are affected in a measure by factors other than the two mentioned above. However, the broad direction is clear. Unless we rein in this too much of a good thing, it will be reined in for us by nature. The mechanisms are not likely to be very pleasant. The most likely ones are famine, violent conflicts, and pandemics. It is unlikely that the solution will be found by governments. They have a maximum of a 5-year window to worry about, and more than that, they are invested in the system so deeply that they cannot afford to even think of options, especially until the crisis becomes very evident. And then it may be too late. The solution will have to come from the public at large. We must then look at what the concerned people can do and need to do. It is interesting to note that the crisis presented above can be seen as an ecological crisis. Broadly, I have eschewed using the word environmental or ecological so far, since most people believe that actions such as switching off the lights when not needed are indeed enough to address our ecological problems. Unfortunately, the crisis is much greater, and nothing short of discovering a new way of thinking, believing, and living will allow us to get out of this hole that we continue to dig ourselves into. I call this hole the ecological imperative. Statement Z. This problem is really an imperative, something that cannot be seen as anything other than a crucial necessity. The response that we create for it will decide the future of the human civilization. Unfortunately, humans are very good at addressing crises that get addressed by adrenaline, but not so good at crises that are slow to come to boil and slower to control. Hence, it is not going to be easy to gather support for responding to this imperative, though it certainly seems solvable even at this late stage. It would probably have been much easier for us to defeat some extraterrestrial marauders, but in this case, we are pitched against our own love for comfort, ossified habits, and our religious belief in the market system. However, those who can see this looming imperative are forced to do their best to find a response for it, whether or not there is sufficient support for the cause. So, I see it, and I am forced to come up with what I think can be an effective response. What is extremely critical to note here is that a solution exists, is very much in our reach, and what's more, it actually makes life even more beautiful than what it currently is. Statement AA. Here is the basic outline. I see that an effective response will need to work at various levels. Individuals will need to believe that something needs to be done urgently. They must want to make relevant changes in their lifestyle, some of those a bit inconvenient initially. Families, in the broadest sense of the word, will need to rally for supporting all their members, for it cannot be addressed at merely individual intellectual level. Families will provide the emotional bulwark. Communities will need to come together and give support on specialized functions that cannot be available in all families. They also need to provide the peer framework that allows a belief system to take root and stay in place. The response must take a form of prototype communities that work and are a happy place to be, without consuming much and with gradually reducing population. I see the response as below. Response to the ecological imperative is equal to simple living and extended negative growth family, or intentional family, and largely self-sufficient community. Mathematically, the expression is as below. REI is equal to LS star in brackets FENG plus FI bracket close star CLS. Statement AB. In other words, each of the following is needed. Individuals will need to give up the desire to consume anything more than what is absolutely necessary for them. They must satisfy their desire to have status and to be respected through other means within their families and communities. Simple living is not so difficult once its benefits become visible to an individual and he or she can find traction to their thoughts within the family or the community. The two options for the kind of a family that is needed are an extended family, as is still seen in many parts of the developing world, a collection of siblings, cousins and their parents, as well as progeny, living under one roof, providing each other effective support as well as the necessary emotional stimulation. Things need to be shared as much as possible. Focus is more on family stuff and less on personal stuff. In one matter though, The new extended family will be different from existing extended families. They will procreate, but with the idea that over time there will be less people in the coming generation than there are in the current generation. In other words, it will be a negative growth family. Eventually, when the family size becomes smaller than is tenable in the system, they will merge with another such family and form an intentional family. The other option is to start with an intentional family. This is also necessary where extended family systems are already broken. In this case, a certain number of individuals will need to come together and get bonded together because of their intention. They will also find prototypes and peer support for such a family from within the community. This is not such an odd presumption. Many people do adopt children and live like biological or genetically connected families. It is all a matter of what is seen as acceptable within the given community. Other examples of currently accepted intentional families would be as below. Individuals and their pets, or a set of the same. Queer couples. Certain kinds of communes. Certain examples of rooming together. Largely self-sufficient community. This is required because human needs are not completely met at the level of the family. There are several interactions that require non-family community around the concerned individual. This community needs to be rather small and reasonably self-sufficient. This will ensure local responsibility to what happens to their earth on their patch. When every community will take responsibility for their own patches, many of the problems seen today will gradually disappear. I need to stress that this plan is not a hark back at some pristine old legend. We have never faced such a challenge, hence we have never had such a solution. This is also not a saint-like system that is being put forward. People will still be people, only their playgrounds decided by their non-BMC driven culture. Non-BMC driven culture. BMC is the short form for beyond minimum consumption. So non-BMC driven culture, BMC being beyond minimum consumption, will be somewhat different. So I repeat the statement. This is also not a saint-like system that is being put forward. People will still be people, only their playgrounds decided by their non-BMC driven culture will be somewhat different. Several people already live parts of this solution in their daily lives. It is just that affluence has made many of us skeptical of the quality of such lives. Also, we, with our BMC lifestyles, affluence, are undermining those structures and systems. This is because the power to direct and influence cultures sits with us, the affluent. And we are deluding people away from their perfectly working systems to a system that is not adoptable by them. The resource systems are already way too low. So those will crash if everyone in the world tries to adopt the lifestyle of the affluent, especially the affluent of North America. Conclusion. I hope some of us will find this paper useful. Irrespective of the number and intensity of disagreements that we may have, with any number of statements outlined in this paper. I do not know of a way to conclude this paper. However, I find that the thoughts that I have at this time are very similar to the ones that I had when I wrote the acknowledgments as a preface to my first collection of poetry, Love? I am simply copying the relevant parts and highlighting some of the same here. This collection is about love, about the various hues of love that I have known intimately. Some of those are of the well-known type, the well-written, the well-read, and the well-felt types. Others are perhaps peculiar to me and those of my kind. But I hope my fundamental love shows through, the love for life, specifically the human life. I therefore must acknowledge the debt of that who or which gave me this life and the love that I needed and still need to go through it. I do not know how this book will be received by my contemporaries, rated by posterity. But if someone, some just one, could find a reflection of his own love in my poetry, I shall consider my job well done. Finally, I need to say that this paper, perhaps in my own peculiar way, is a love letter to my first mother, my earth, my Gaia. I hope the other lovers of Gaia will bring this paper to the mainstream of love and bring the mainstream of love to this paper and beyond, and help make this world move towards satisfaction through love rather than through power and through consumption. Please do look out for newer versions of this paper. I expect this to be a living document and hope to modify it based on feedback and discussions that I hope will follow. The first release of this paper was on 8th of August 2006. Thanks for reading, listening, or watching this paper and this text movie through. Please note, this document is for free distribution. I, that is OVICE, hold the copyright and modification rights, but everyone and anyone can utilize this document in service of the Mother Earth. No one, however, is permitted to monetarily benefit from the use of this document in full or in part. All profits thus made must be donated to an organization of good standing, working in service of Earth's ecology. In order to facilitate the usage of parts of this document in good faith, I have not put any copyright on this, except to the extent that I hold the copyright for the public. I shall, however, not be responsible for any unauthorized modifications made in this document or text movie by someone in the transmission chain, by good or malintent. For the latest authorized version of this paper and feedback, please use the URL that you will find on my channel, on this text movie, or in the description. Thank you very much. Bye-bye. OVICE.